lesbian section, and I'm very excited to be here today. So this presentation is showing the preliminary findings for my PhD research, which I'm doing through the Australian Catholic University in Australia. My research team includes my three wonderful supervisors, Sharla Media, Sarah Bays and Valerie Wilson, and I really thank them for all the support that they've given me through this. Okay, next slide, thank you. And I'm sharing this with you today from Nowra in New South Wales, Australia, and I'm on the lands of the Dharawal Aboriginal people of the Yuin Nation, and I acknowledge that that is where I'm sharing from and are the people who have been on this land and birthing babies for a very long time. I also want to acknowledge that not all of the women who are in this, so not all birthing people identify as women or mothers, and this study presents findings for those who do call themselves women. Thank you. So this was the problem, separating mothers from their baby at caesarean section birth without medical need. And this is what I was seeing within my clinical work as a lactation consultant in my local health district, women coming back to see me for their next baby because of breastfeeding problems, but also describing the trauma that they had experienced being separated from their baby at birth. Thank you. So what do we already know? So we know women do not want to be separated from their baby at caesarean section birth, and they really want to see and to hold and to feed their baby as they start to become a mother and get to know their baby. And skin-to-skin contact between a well woman and her baby at caesarean section helps keep the mother and baby together. So it's like the vehicle for keeping them in the one room attached to each other. And it means that both mother and baby get their wants and their needs met. And it's very simple, it's safe, and it protects their future physical and emotional well-being. And skin to skin it helps ensure a positive birth experience and a sense of control, which impacts birth experience. And you can read more about that in the paper that I released, my literature review, which was released in 2021.
Linda, you should have control to progress to the next slide by yourself now.
Beautiful. Thank you. So if we think women are going to remember and be impacted by their birth experience for the rest of their lives, and for those of you who have had children, I know this will resonate really strongly with you. So you remember what has happened, who was there with you, what they said to you, and how you were feeling. And skin to skin at caesarean section isn't anything new. So it was first described in 2008 by Smith et al., just calling it a natural caesarean. So we've been doing skin to skin at vaginal births for a long time, and we know there's so much evidence that shows how good this is. So just from this first description here, that was 15 years, which I think fits really well with VIDM, because it's the same time that they've been around as well. But we're still missing this link, and it's not happening consistently with mothers and babies and keeping them together. So this is the study design and analysis. So it was a feminist phenomenological framework, and feminist because the phenomenology, so that human experience, is very much not a gender neutral experience, and women are having babies. Participants were sought through social media in Australia, and there was an overwhelming response. So this was put out into a consumer advocacy group, and within 24 hours there was a huge number of responses. It got shared widely. And these women that chose to, wanted to be involved, they were doing it for altruistic reasons. It was very purposive sampling as well, because we wanted women who had experienced separation from their baby non-medically. So there wasn't, no mothers were sick, no babies were sick. So 15 women who had experienced this separation from their baby were included and then interviewed. So anywhere between 5 months and 10 years previously. The interviews took 1 to 2 hours and were very emotional interviews. Data was analysed using a modified van Kaam approach, and that is when you group the data, reduce it, theme it, validate it, and then describe it. And it was viewed through two feminist birthing experience theories, one by Fay and Parrott, which is birth territory, and the other by Rachel Reid, childbirth as a rite of passage. So the participants aged in range between 23 and 38 for their birth of separation. They were all married or in a relationship and well-educated. The caesarean section with separation had happened between that 5 months and 10 years prior to being interviewed. 14 out of 15 were primips at the time of their first separation, and two experienced a repeated birth with a separation. So there were 17 total birth experiences. 12 of those were emergency procedures. And in pregnancy, all of these women planned and engaged with healthcare providers. They looked for people who were going to help them achieve their goals. So they chose people who they felt aligned with their own ideas. So two of them had planned home births. One was going through a birthing centre. Seven chose private obstetricians. And this was because they thought that they would get continuity of care, which they may not get in the public health system. And two of them had doulas. All of these women birthed in Australia. So looking at the findings and what the people were saying, where's my baby was a common theme, and which is why it's the title. So women were saying that they wanted to know where their baby was. The overarching sort of themes that were coming out of this, like the first thing, they were unable to hold their baby. So they didn't get to see their baby or hold their baby. They were separated from their baby. There wasn't skin to skin. But it was more than just the separation of the mother and baby. So it was very hard to just to pull that tiny little piece out of their entire birth experience. So covering their pregnancy right through to postpartum and birth debriefing afterwards as well. There was, you know, that really the physical hormonal response to having a baby. And many of these women had been labouring prior to the birth by caesarean section. That whole experience and each one impacting the other. There was general disregard for women, which is where that feminist notion really comes into it. And there was obstetric violence and neglect. And that was very obvious in the stories that the women were told. And we don't think of that often in my country, in Australia, that there is violence involved with this. Now, I'd like to share with you some of the stories from the women. So some really lovely quotes that they had to say. Well, they're not always lovely about each of these themes. So really wanting but unable to hold their baby. And the women were asking to hold their baby. These weren't women who were lying there benignly. They were saying they wanted to hold their baby, but they were not supported to do so. Participant one said, "I want to see my baby. I want him brought to me now." But that didn't happen. And participant 12 said, "I was just like, please, please let me see my baby." And these women are physically unable to hold their baby, to do it themselves. They're very vulnerable. So we give them a spinal anesthetic so they can't get up. We then put blood pressure cuffs. We put IV cannulas. We put clothing like gowns. We tuck them in with blankets. So we make it really hard. They can't do it themselves. Participant 12 said, "My hands were down, so because they had cannulas in, so I couldn't actually touch her, but my husband held her to my cheek and I was able to cuddle into her for a little bit, which was beautiful." So even that tiny little touch that she got was important for that woman. Participant 10 said that she wanted to do something so that I could hold him a bit more, like there was a lot in the way. The participants all talked as well about their babies being rubbed and wiped and cleaned and weighed. Cords were cut and wrapped. They were often unable to see their baby and unsure if they're even well or alive. Just when you think about the design of, if you think about just the design of the theatre rooms, and often the trolleys for that we resuscitate babies or take babies to, even when they don't need resuscitating, are on the other side of the room. Participant 15 said, "The whole time that I was, that the caesarean was occurring, I thought he was dead." And that woman had been coerced into having a caesarean section by being told that her baby was going to die if she didn't have it. And he didn't cry when he was first born. He was well, had apgars of 9 and 10, but he didn't cry. So she still thought he was dead and she couldn't see him. Participant 11 said, "They were crowding her a lot, so I couldn't really see her that much." And participant 2 said, "They're cleaning every sign of me from her." And then the women were unsure whether they were allowed to ask for their baby. And I know all the midwives that are listening to this will all be cringing at that word allowed, because it's a word that we tend to not like very much, isn't it? But this is what women are expecting, that they will somebody let me do something? Will they allow me to do something? And participant 10 said, I was sort of hoping he would come to me, but we really didn't voice that very clearly in the theatre. And I think it's sad that women feel that they need to advocate themselves when they're in a position of such vulnerability. So no skin to skin. There were two participants who were given very brief skin to skin while they were in the operating theatre, but it didn't continue out into recovery. So thinking about skin to skin, what the recommendations are, what we're assessed for when you think of baby friendly health initiative. So it's at least 1 hour of uninterrupted immediate skin to skin. In theatre, you know, they class this once they get out to recoveries, you know, when we're having a BFHI assessment, but this wasn't happening for these women. One participant said, my midwife kind of grabbed him off the peds and kind of got him to me and opened my gown and tried to rip the blankets off him and get him onto my chest. So there was a lot happening for this woman, but she still had a midwife who was trying to do the best that she could. But that healthcare provider advocacy was quite rare, didn't happen very often. Participant 4 said she literally went against everything that had been organised, so no delayed cord clamping or skin to skin. And participant 6 said, I was told I was not allowed to do that because of infection control. And then healthcare provider, and I'm not just talking about midwives here, this is all of the people that are involved with the birth of these babies. Obstruction was also, unfortunately, quite common. Participant 13 said they didn't talk about skin to skin or anything like that. So it was just slice, cut, over to the table, do all the things, weigh, wrap her up, and then bring her to me all wrapped up. The women's choices were completely disregarded, and the focus was really on the staff, not on the women. And this participant 4 said, you know, having mum and bub together and in skin-to-skin contact costs the hospital nothing. And I think we know this. And, you know, there might be arguments about the time that midwives may have to spend doing skin-to-skin, but there's already midwives there. There are very few births, at least within Australia, where there isn't a midwife there with the mother while she's having her baby. And then the period of actual separation. So just as a general thing, women didn't understand why they were separated from their baby. They understood that if one of them was sick, that would happen, but these were well mothers, well babies. Participant 6 said she was just confused as to why I couldn't have my baby. Participant 9 said, I kept on asking and asking and they just didn't. Participant 13 said, it felt like forever. And 14 said, they took him, I didn't hold him for 2 hours. She was crying as she explained this. I didn't know what had happened to him. And then participant 2 said she was taken. I don't see her face. They take her away. These were really emotional responses when women were talking about this. There was lots of crying. They also didn't think that the staff understood the importance of this. They just thought it as very much being a clinical medical procedure, not a birth. Participant 9 said, I just didn't feel like they really understood the urgency of it, how important it was to me. I was sent to recovery for 5 hours. She was deliberately keeping me there to keep me separated from my baby. That was participant 4. And participant 3 said, but I guess they didn't see it as being important. And I think as we're listening to this, we do see the value in this. And this probably grates on many of you as you're listening to these stories. There was a lot of emotional turmoil and, as I said, lots of people crying. There was people very angry when they were recounting their birth stories. You know, there were feelings of fear and trauma during that actual period of birth, and that separation made way to those that they were angry, they were sad, they were guilty because they couldn't fix things. And those feelings were still very strong in the present at the time that they were sharing them as well. Relationships were impacted, particularly with their partners. And participant one said the damage that it does first hand on, you know, not just with breastfeeding relationships, but entire family units can suffer because of this. So this is relationships with, you know, their families, and it's ongoing. It doesn't just stop at when the baby's been born. Participant Poo too said, I was a very sexual person. We had a very healthy, nice sexual life before, and I cannot even have effing sex with my husband now. He was the only person who could have said stop, but he was silent and calm. It was one way of siding with the hospital. And then the connection with babies as well. And this is why we really, really want mothers and babies to stay together at birth, is so that they look after and love and care and feed and their babies from birth onwards. Participant 15 said, to be honest, I didn't feel very connected to him. I didn't feel that bond with him for a good couple of months. Participant 12 said, at first I was jealous because he loved everyone but me. And participant 2 said, I have a good relationship with her, but a lot of it, it's out of duty. I know how I have to behave, but it's not this natural, overjoyed burst of emotion. And that mum's child was heading up to 2 years old. And then participant 5 said, I didn't feel connected to her, but I think it was just, it still felt theoretical. You know, there was something that was just off, and it just took time. This is just looking at, you know, some of the words and the frequency of the words that were used. And, you know, their immediate responses were often numbness, weirdness. It felt very clinical. They felt like they didn't have any control in that early period. But then looking back at the birth is this retrospective feeling. So, you know, anger, frustration, these people were unhappy. They were confused. They were powerless. These people, these were really strong emotions that they still had many years after the birth for some of them. So looking at, with this study, looking at the perspective through a feminist theory, just explaining what the two theories were. So birth territory by Faye and Parrott. So it's really understanding that maternal experience of birth by the environment that the woman is birthing in and who has power and control within that space. So the terrain and the jurisdiction. And if you think about the terrain of a caesarean section, it's very clinical, monitored, unfamiliar. It's termed the surveillance room, and it's got that potential for emotional distress and reduced physical functioning. And in a vaginal birth, this means women don't birth, you know, they don't continue to contract and things like that. But for a mother birthing in a caesarean section, this means that she also has lots of emotional responses that continue on beyond the birth. But we can challenge that. The people that are in the room, if you have shared goals, you're maintaining safety for the woman and respectful protection of the woman and giving her the sense of choice and control. So letting her have a say in what is happening to her can really change her experience. And midwives, we're the people in that room that can make a difference. So we're there to, we can advocate for keeping mothers and babies together and in skin-to-skin contact. And the birth territory describes this as midwifery guardianship, and it's a form of integrative power, so returning power to the woman. The opposite of that is midwifery domination, and that's disintegrative power, and it's more often seen in that place that women are birthing with caesarean sections, so that patriarchal medical system. So women are expected to behave. If they don't behave, if they decline treatment, refuse care, you just imagine the documentation. I know all of you are thinking about things that you've seen in patients' notes, you know, that people refusing to do what they've been told because they expect it to be good. They're disciplined for non-compliance, and there's often very subtle and coercive reactions to that as well. And then childbirth is a rite of passage. This is Rachel Reed's work. And it's understanding the phases of birth, and that's from pregnancy right through to the postpartum period, that her whole journey takes with a non, and it includes a non-physiological or surgical environment. And it talks about both the rites of passage for the woman and also rites of protection, which are more important when a woman is having a birth, such as a caesarean section. And again, the midwife is really central to both of those. The birth phases that were talked about in this theory is preparation. And that's, you know, the woman where she gets to develop trust in herself. This is her birth. And she writes birth plans. She anticipates the baby coming. You don't want her to be feeling anxious in this time, but she does feel a bit anxious because it's unpredictable. And many women, including the participants, had planned for unexpected. They knew that cesarean section may happen in their future, but let them meet the team, you know, so and support them as they're making those birth plans. The separation period is a time when they're getting ready for birth, and this for a cesarean section, the women coming into the hospital, meeting the staff as they come in because today's the day their baby has come. Introducing them to people who are in the room is really important. Minimizing distractions, let them know what's going on. And what you say and do at that point is really important for their birth experience. Liminality is also a phrase that's called the betwixt and between, which is probably more obvious at vaginal births. So women really head into another place as they prepare to push their babies out. But there are still a lot of endorphins and, you know, altered states of consciousness in that time. They're often very open to suggestion from authority figures. And a lot of the women in these stories were already labouring before the cesarean section. So being told that their baby was going to die, it was an incentive to go and have a cesarean section, even if it wasn't realistic. So for us, remaining with women, advocating, supporting. And then with emergence, this is the birth. We often, you know, call this emergency rather than emergence as well when someone's having a cesarean. But thinking about the woman's preferences, still providing respectful care for her. Does she want the drapes lowered? Does she want somebody in particular to announce the sex of the baby or to see that themselves? And then integration, which is really the focus of this study, which is when the mother and baby are first meeting, so not separating them skin to skin. This is all about also about the time where women talk their birth stories, get debriefed about their birth, and thinking about birth debrief is not just a clinical trying to stop somebody getting sued, but you know, which is often what was happening. You know, there's a lot of women's experiences were just completely disregarded in the clinical debriefs, complaint processes that were done. Reed says, a positive and empowering birth is more strongly related to how a woman is treated by care providers than how she gives birth. And I think that's really important. So those rights of protection are what we need to be supporting as midwives and giving the woman back the power. And there was so much more than just that separation. So yes, taking babies from their mothers, not giving them skin to skin, not letting them hold and feed their babies straight away is all really important, but it's a part of a bigger picture. And that overall birth experience was really negatively associated with separation, but how she felt in that time. You know, there's a lot of expected physical and hormonal responses to labour and stress. So thinking about all those catecholamines like adrenaline, noradrenaline and cortisol, and they cause physical responses in women, shaking, memory loss, change to memories, things like that. And that further impacted the women in these this study of the moments of meeting their babies and what they remembered. And some women didn't remember things. One participant, seven, said it took about 5 minutes for them to do all of their checks and whatever they're doing. They brought him back, but I had really bad shaking. And then participant 12 said, they kept saying, you can't go up until you stop shaking. That was, she wanted to go back to her baby. And I'm like, I can't stop shaking. And some memories of the time as well. So being aware of what the time is, there's often not a clock that women can look at either. And, you know, time can be very warped. Some women were able to track time because of things that were happening. So they knew that at the time that their husband left or when I was taken to the ward. But some people use timestamps on their phone, and participant seven said that. She said, I'm not sure who had my phone. Somebody was taking photos, so I can actually track the time of, like, how long did it take to do stuff. But participant nine, who didn't have photos, said they checked him, then he was on me, but it wasn't for very long. And participant eight, when asked, How long had she been separated for? She said, I have zero memory of it. My memory is of zero time. Participant 14 said, we're not the priority at all. We're just a cog in the hospital machine, just getting churned out like a sausage. And participant 15 really described the cold hostility from her doctor because she didn't agree to his timing of the caesarean section. She said, I feel like the system fails women, and I feel if men give birth, the system would really, really support them. But I think the birthing system is not supportive of women because it's women that give birth. Like, and I have never known such inequality as I do now. And I think this is really looking at that patriarchal medical system. But midwives, we're in that system. We can make changes. So we are the key, and that art and science of midwifery really shows that we are best placed to create a protective and supportive environment and improve that birthing experience. We can return that power and control back to the woman by letting her choose what happens to her body and her baby. And that helps, we can help that by keeping mothers and babies together. And birthing women shouldn't be expected to advocate for themselves. And nor should their partners. We can prime up the partners to be doing this, but I think it was very evident with these women as well that the partners were often very vulnerable as well. So again, it comes back to midwives. We really do hold the key in this. And this is, yes, definitely watch this space. This is my Twitter handle at Linda Deys. So as new papers come out over this year, you'll see some more come through and you'll see more of these findings coming out. So hopefully you will look out for those. And they're my references there. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Linda. I'm just having a look at the chat. Lisa says, I think as midwives, we have to be prepared to rock the boat. Janine just says, thank you. Great job. There's no other questions. So thank you so much, Linda, for participating in the Virtual International Day of the Midwife.